Good morning. Let's try that one more time. Good morning, countryside. All right, let's all stand together. We're going to get started singing with an oldie but goldie. Come, now is the time to worship.
Is the time to worship? Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are.
To be in the house of the Lord this morning, say amen with me. All right, we are gonna have our song during the time where we typically do our greeting. If you are gonna travel around the room greeting today, we ask that you be mindful of social and physical distancing practices. Wear a mask if you're gonna do that. This is also the time during our service where if you came prepared to give tithes or offerings, you can do that. There's a box in the back in front of the sound booth for that. Also, if you're a visitor, there's visitor cards back there. We'd love to have a record of your visit. And there's a prayer box back there as well. So if you have a prayer request for us that you'd like for us to make a part of our prayer this week, then just leave that for us there as well. Any announcements that you can think of? Coming. All right, our 4-H, Countryside 4-H crew had our fair this week. It's actually still going on. Five members from Countryside participated. I think all of them had some ribbon this weekend. They've all done really well, so congrats to those guys. We're going to sing a song called Old Church Choir, and you guys can greet away.
this revival, and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Once you choose it, you can't lose it. 'Cause there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. And it's beautiful. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing 'cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. Oh, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy.
Amen. You can all be seated.
Amen. All right. So, how many watched the video, the announcements that were beforehand, before the service, and so forth, the clips that go by, and so forth and so on? Not very many. So, how many times did you see an announcement about Spring Forward next week? Anybody remember? No. Spring Forward next Sunday. I had it in there four times so that you would remember that next week the clock changes and you lose an hour. Okay? All right. So he's going to play the video announcements for the week right here.
Good morning and welcome to Countryside Baptist Church.
Whether you've chosen to join us at our 9 o'clock service or our 10:30 service, we're glad that you're with us today. We want to remind you that we're taking up donations for the food drive today.
You can put your check in the offering box on the memo. Make sure you put children's table or food drive.
The bus came this past Friday, so it will be here again March the 19th if you want to take advantage of that. The schedule after that is every other Friday also.
At what time?
1 o'clock.
Next Sunday is the 14th, and also that is the Sunday before St. Patrick's Day. So we challenge you to
wear your green so you don't get pinched. Hey, Jess, what's your secret sister item for the month of March?
It is a sock. Well, two socks because you have 2 feet, or slippers.
They usually come in pairs.
Right. So socks or slippers for the month of March for your secret sister item. Don't forget to recognize her at least on a monthly basis.
Do you have any secret sisters that are pirates?
No, but I feel a dad joke coming on.
You might get away with one sock.
Oh, okay. Pastor's sermon series for March will be Women of the Bible. We hope you can join us to enjoy those sermons.
He's going to tell us all about the good ones and the bad ones.
I hope I'm a good one.
You are.
Oh.
We want to thank you for coming out to Countryside to worship with us here today.
We hope you have a great week. Good morning and welcome to Countryside Baptist Church.
Whether you've chosen.
Choi! I was supposed to start, wasn't I?
You were. What is the secret sister item for the month?
That was so bad.
It would have been fine.
All right, our pastor is coming up to lead in the Lord's Supper.
So we're not being irreverent, but we do have a good time in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And we're glad you're here today. We believe in open communion, which means you don't have to be a member of our church to take this. But I do ask that you make sure that you know the Lord is your Savior, number one, and that you've confessed your sin, number two. So we always start with a quiet time of reflection. And I'm going to read a couple of scriptures after that, and then we'll take the Lord's Supper. So let's pray. And at this time, if there's anything in your life that's displeasing to the Lord, anything that God is pointing out to you that's wrong, now's the time to confess that to Him. So let's pray. Lord, we do come before you now, and Lord, we confess our sins of commission, things that we've actually done we shouldn't have done, Lord. And Lord, those sins of omission, those things that we should have done that we didn't do. So right now, Lord, all with one accord, we've prayed and sought your forgiveness. And thank you, Lord, for your shed blood on Calvary, the fact that you tell us if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So our whole group, Lord, right now have come before you. And Lord, our hearts and minds, hopefully each and every one are clean before you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The Word of God says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning with verse 23, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. This do in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself, if he does not judge the body rightly." So we start with judging ourselves. We confess our sins. We get things right. And then we're ready to take the elements. Now be real careful. Show the little children with you how to do it. Pull the very top little paper off, the little clear one off, and you can get to the bread. And don't open the cup yet, because it will spill on your clothes, kids, okay? But let's hold the cup up, hold the bread up. And what it says, Jesus took the bread and he did what? He broke it. So break it in half. And that symbolizes the body of our Lord Jesus Christ being hurt, broken, crucified for us. And it says when he had given thanks, they take the bread. So Lord, we thank you right now for what you did long ago on the cross when you gave your body for us. In Jesus' name, amen. And it says he took the cup. So carefully peel that cup back. Take the paper off of it and hold it up before the Lord. He said, this cup is a new covenant, New Testament, a new agreement between us. And that agreement is this. If we trust this, the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, His Son, He said He'll cleanse us from all sin. And He pays a way for us to go to heaven through the shed blood a long time ago on Calvary. Aren't you glad that He did that for you? Hold it up and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Amen. Thank you for those of you that prepared the elements.
Amen. All right. You ready to sing some more? I got a team coming up over there that's going to help us sing some hymns together. Probably do the first one and the third one, Tyler. The first one and the third one. We will skip the second one. Okay? Let's stand together as we sing. Amen. Roll.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing. The promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior is my all in all. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
I'm standing on the promises of God. Amen. All right. Move to He Touched Me. Thank you. All right.
Shackled by a heavy burden, neath a load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me, and I'm
Amen. You may be seated as the kids leave for Kids Town. There they go.
Amen. Aren't you glad that God made a woman, fellas? Amen. Amen. God's good. God's so wise. And as we enter and begin to celebrate the history of woman is this month. I don't know if you knew that, but this is Women's Month or Women's Month. And so the sermon series is all going to be about women. Now, you guys need to respond to the Lord, too. You need to put God first in your life. But I'm going to aim for the girls and celebrate them a little bit during this month and this sermon series. So you hang with us, guys, and you do what God's telling you to do as well. But the title is Girls on a Mission, Finding God's Special Plan for Your Life as a Woman. Did you realize God has a special plan for you ladies right now? You are so critical in our culture right now. You're critical for the survival of America. You ladies, and you say, well, I'm just insignificant. Nobody knows who I am, and I don't have any power. No, wait a minute. Quit making those excuses and stop and listen for a minute. When God made when he created everything, the very last part of creation was what? He made a woman. He saved the best for last. So God has something important for you to do. And your life is critical right here and now. And I hope that I can challenge you during this month. And I hope the God of heaven will challenge you to be a godly woman that will find your special plan, something that God has for you to do right here and right now in America. We're going to look today at the first one we're going to look at, and I guess Mary would probably have to be considered one of the most important women in history, wouldn't you say? And, you know, some Christian faiths worship her. We don't worship Mary, but we sure hold her in high esteem, don't we? The mother of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we're going to illustrate some stuff from her life today because God's miracles on earth have frequently involved girls. And I'm going to say girls instead of women, okay? Because when I look at you, even though you might be old, we still think you're girls. How many of you ladies like to be thought of, I'm still a girl? Huh? Yeah, most of you say, well, if I could just go back and be a girl. Well, you are a girl, and you should be proud of it. And God's frequently involved girls in the miracles that he did on earth. And as we look at this young girl that God used to do something so very important, and her name was Mary. So I'm going to take you to the scripture. You can read along on the screen, or you can look it up in your Bible, either way. But I'm going to read it out loud to you as you read along silently with me. Are you ready to go? Luke chapter 1, verse 5. There was in the days of Herod the king of Judea a certain priest named Zacharias of the course of Abia, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was, what's her name? Elizabeth. Oops, got me. I'm ahead of you. I got one ahead of you there. I got my wrong scripture up there on that slide, guys. On mine, it's verse 5. We missed verse 5. So anyway, verse 6, the end of my verse in verse 5 says her name is Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. And they had no child because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both now well stricken in years. Now, as you think about this scripture, verses 5 and 6, God was looking for a special girl on earth. He was looking for a special girl to come to do something really important. Really the most important thing that's ever been done by a woman on earth, I believe, was what Mary did when she brought Jesus into the world. Verse 26 says, I'll make sure my slides are corresponding. I have my pad up here, and we have two PowerPoints, so making sure they're right. It said, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God into the city of Galilee named Nazareth. Was it say to what? To a what? To a virgin, espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. Two times in these scriptures, the important word is used there, virgin. You see that twice. Modern skeptics of the Bible say Mary wasn't a virgin, and she did this and she did that, and Jesus might have been the son of a Roman soldier. Just all kind of nonsense. Listen, we believe in the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's a cardinal doctrine of the scripture that we firmly believe in. Here it says that to a virgin, verse 27, espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. Verse 28, and the angel came unto her and said, hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what salutation this should be. You see, when the angel came, he was looking for a virgin. Why was he looking for a virgin? Because the scripture said the Messiah was going to be born of a virgin. That's why. So he was looking for a virgin, and he was looking for a godly girl. A godly girl of that period of time that was a virgin. Did you realize there can be godly girls today that are virgins in America? Really, there can be. But you think, no way, not in America. Oh, yeah, there can be, and there should be. And I believe that we have some of them here, and I hope we can convince a whole lot more of them to keep themselves until marriage and hope they'll be virgins when they get married. But we also tell the guys the same thing. Wouldn't it be neat if you young ladies could get to the altar and your man had never been with a woman and you'd never been with a man until that night? Wouldn't that be wonderful? Well, see, that's what God was looking for. He was looking for this virgin. He was looking for a godly girl. But he was also looking for a girl with plans for her life. Did you realize that most girls today that give themselves away early have no plans for their life? They're looking for that immediate love or gratification, whatever. They're looking for an escape from their home sometimes. They're looking for a party, whatever. They really don't have any plans other than the moment. And yet, God was looking for a girl that had plans for the future. You see, when a girl decides to keep herself from marriage and a girl decides to really be that godly girl, she has plans. She's thinking ahead rather than right now. And the angel was looking for this one that had plans for her life. You see, God was wanting to give her a special mission. And I really believe with all my heart that God has a special mission for each and every young lady that's born today. I really believe that you girls have a special mission from God. And you, it won't be to bear the Messiah because he's already here and he's already come. He's already done his great work and gone back to heaven. But he has something else very important for you to do. And you don't even know what it is yet, but I pray that you will catch the burden and catch the vision. And you will be that girl like Mary was. See, God had gave her a special mission on this earth. Verse 30 says, "And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there shall be no end." Only one girl in history would have this job, this particular miracle. She would bring forth Messiah. And all the Jewish girls of that period of time and before her probably thought, "Will it be me? Will it be me? Will I be the one that get to bring Messiah into the world?" And here God chooses this little girl, little teenage girl named Mary. There would be no other child like this ever born on planet Earth. You see, Jesus is one of a kind. He's the only God-man. He's 100% God and he's 100% man at the same time. And yet, there was only one of them. See, we're children of God when we believe in Christ. We become the very children of God. But we're not the son, the only begotten Son of God, like this was, and here she was chosen to do that. You see, Mary was chosen to do it, but she had a specific problem. What was her problem? Well, verse 34 said it was a problem. She said, "Then Mary said unto the angel, How shall this be? I don't know a man. I've never been to bed with a man." You know, really, she said, "I've never slept with a man. How can I have a baby? How am I going to have this baby when I've never been to bed with a man? And I don't have any experience in this. I've never done this before. And the fact, I'm already engaged to Joseph. You know, I'm holding myself and keeping myself for Joseph. How will this happen?" But see, God had a solution, didn't he? He had a very special solution for Mary for this particular problem. And verse 35 says, "The angel answered her and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she's also conceived a son in her old age, and this is a sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible." Isn't it interesting? Two miraculous births tied together. One was an old lady, couldn't have babies. Another one was a virgin that had never had relations with a man. Two miracle births happening pretty much within 6 months or so of one another. Listen, we are serving the God that can do the impossible. And here he picked this girl to do this particular mission for him on planet Earth. And the angel assured her that God would take care of all the details. Ladies and girls, listen. When God calls you to be that godly girl on the earth, and you wonder, how in the world can I do that? How can I be that girl upon the earth? God's already worked out all the details for you. You say, "I don't know if I can do that." You can, because God's already worked out all the details. He's got the plan in place for you, and he's going to help you accomplish that. Second thing, he explained the miracle to her. He said, "You know, here's how it's going to happen. The Holy Ghost is going to come and overshadow you. You're going to have a baby by him." You know, and she's going, "I still don't quite understand it, you know." But he gave her special information about a miracle that was already underway. You see, the miracle was conceived in the mind of God in eternity past. God already knew what he was going to do. And it was just her time in history when he decided to do it. Miracle had already been planned. It already been, everything had been all worked out. And it was just, God was looking for the right time, looking for the right person to accomplish this miracle. And God is looking right now into your heart and your mind, girls, because he's looking for girls today, not to bring Messiah into the world, but to be a different kind of girl, to be a different kind of woman. Because, see, the world is filled with the other kind of women that don't really have a plan, and, you know, they don't really keep themselves for God. They don't really give their hearts to God. They don't really put God first. Plenty of girls like that. But the girls out there that love the Lord with all their heart and they set themselves apart for Him, they're very rare. The Bible says to find a virtuous woman like that is like finding a ruby, a beautiful ruby out there if you're looking for diamonds and rubies. It said very rare, yet they're there, and God has them. Now, Mary had a special answer for the Lord. When the Lord came and talked to her and told her what was happening, in verse 38, Mary said, "Behold, the handmaiden of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word." And the angel departed from her. Oh, Mary said, "Here I am. I'm the Lord's handmaid. I'm His servant. He can do whatever He wants to in my life." Have you really come to the point in your life, young ladies and older ladies and all girls that are here today, have you come to that point in your life where you said, "Lord, I'm yours. Whatever you want, I just want to be your girl. I just want to live for you. I want to represent you on this earth. I want to keep myself for you. I want to stay pure and holy before you." I hope you're like that. I hope you've made that choice. She said, "I yield my life and my plans to Him." Have you, as a young lady, come to that point where you said, "Whatever the future holds, it's in your hands, Lord. I've yielded myself to you." See, some of you are married. Some of you are not. Some of you are planning marriage. Some of you are not even to that point yet. Put all those things out of your mind for a moment and think about what Mary said. You know, "I yield my life and my plans to you." See, all that really matters in the whole scheme of history is, are you going to be that kind of girl? Are you going to be the kind of girl that Mary was when she yielded her life and her plans to the Lord? She had other plans. What was her plans? Who can tell me what Mary's plans were? Before this happened, what was her plans? Anybody know? Come on, talk to me. What was her plan? She told the angel, "I'm engaged," remember? She said, "I'm engaged." So what do you think she'd been doing for the past 6 months before this? Do you think she might have been planning a wedding? How many of you girls like to plan weddings? Raise your hand. I know Jesse's back there. All of y'all, hey, that's just a girl thing. Good. That's not bad. That's good. But you make plans. You plan things out. You probably plan things out better than your boyfriend does or the men do, don't you? You like to have stuff in place. And she had things in place. She had her plans in place. And yet God had a plan for her. But you know what? As I said at the beginning, God is still looking for special ladies like you to carry out His mission in our time. Boy, wouldn't America be a great place if suddenly 100,000 or 200,000 girls just like you said, "I will not live in sin. I will serve the Lord. I'm going to serve Him and do what He wants me to do. No matter what the world's doing, I don't care. I'm going to serve God." What do you think would happen to our culture? I promise you this, a revival would happen. Yeah, a revival would happen, and you'd see it start to spread. Because all the great revivals of history have always started with young people that said, "I don't care what the world's going to do. As for me and my future, I'm going to stand for God." And it would start with a handful of young people, in your case, a handful of girls. How many girls we have in here? 25 or 30 or so? 30 girls like you that would say, "Lord, I'm going to be like Mary. I'm going to set myself apart for you. I want to live for you. I want to honor you." You see, God is looking for ladies like you. See, every girl has the potential to be highly favored of God. Remember we read the scripture. It said she was highly favored of God. Every girl has that potential. Wouldn't you like to, when history is all written down, wouldn't you like your name to be in that slot? What's your name? On three, say your first name on three. All real loud so I can hear you. One, two, three. Say it one more time. One, two, three. All put that name in the slot. Katie and Bonnie and Ella and whoever and Jordan. You know, they're highly favored of God. Wouldn't that be neat? Your name be written there? Well, it can be, and it will if you serve God and you put Him first. See, God is looking for girls in our generation to put their lives on the line like Mary did and be that kind of woman. See, every girl has the potential to walk with God. I was awakened this morning at 4 o'clock, and my grandsons were in there snoring. We had three grandsons, three handsome grandsons, by the way, young ladies, teenagers. What did Wiley say? He said to advertise. He said they are what now?
He said you would advertise.
But what did he say? He gave certain words. He told me.
Not available. I don't know. There's something you always say.
Said they're available and ready to mingle.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, that's Wiley's commercial.
No.
Said it single and ready to mingle. That's what they said. Anyway, I thought that was cute. Anyway, they're good boys. But you know what? I want to find them one day when they get old enough. I want to find them some good girls. There's going to have to be some good girls somewhere because there are people like us that are trying to raise some good boys. And hopefully they will keep themselves and be pure and good for that time. And hopefully you're that kind of girl. You'll say, I don't care what has happened in the past. From today forward, I am going to be that girl like Mary. I'm going to set myself apart for God. I'm going to walk with God. Oh, the sermon that God gave me at 4 o'clock. I woke up thinking about Eve. You ever heard a sermon just on Eve? Anybody ever heard? I've never heard a whole sermon on Eve. You're going to hear one because God gave me one at 4 o'clock. I wrote the whole thing as if thoughts were just coming. I can't lay there and not go write it down because my brain doesn't work that way. If I don't write it down, I forget it. I mean, I'll forget my dreams if I ever have a dream. If I don't write it down, I'll forget it. So I got up. I was typing away, you know. So I've got some cool stuff the Lord was telling me about Eve that I didn't know before. I've read about her. But I even went online and was researching what Wikipedia says about Eve, and read, and finally got sleepy, went back and caught another hour of a nap, got up, came on. But you'll hear a sermon on Eve because she's one of the most important women in history, isn't she? The mother of all living. But see, that's not just all she was. There's so much more to her life. And listen, there's so much more to your life. You say, I'm just insignificant. Nobody knows my name. Nobody will ever know my name. I'm not famous. I didn't win The Voice, and I'm not. I never would make it. America's Got Talent and American Idol. All those things, you know, and that's all irrelevant. All that really matters: are you a girl that will say, "With I will walk with God, no matter what everybody else does"? See, there are people like that on the earth. There are girls on the earth that will make that decision and say, I don't care what the world is doing. I'm going to walk with God with my life. And Mary was that kind of girl. And every girl has that potential to walk with God. Every girl has the ability to control her desires until marriage. Every girl has that built into her. Not all accomplish it. But it's there. You have the power to. You have the power to control those desires, which are good desires. God put them there. But they need to be contained and controlled until the right time. Every girl has a special mission from God. It won't be to bring Messiah into the world. He's already come and gone, hasn't he? He's already been here. He's accomplished his mission. But there's a whole lot more that you can do by being a godly woman. Listen, ladies, girls, y'all have so much power and so much potential, you underestimate how powerful you really are. You underestimate how powerful you are in our culture and what you can do to help turn it back to the God of the Bible. See, the highest calling you could ever have is to be a godly woman on planet Earth. Because if you are that, and if you will be that, you will be like a diamond out there compared to what is floating around in the world today. Because there's a whole lot of girls out there that aren't sold out to God. There's a whole lot of boys out there and men that aren't sold out to God. They're a dime a dozen. There are millions of them. 7.5 billion on the earth and growing, you know, that we have in the world. And most of those are not walking with God. But you could be that if you want to be. But see, it starts with a desire. It starts with a determination on your part. The highest calling you could ever have is to get to be a godly woman on planet Earth. So you may or may not ever get to bear children, and that's okay. Nothing wrong with, if you can't have children, there's nothing wrong with you because you can't. If you get to, God bless you, because you're gonna bring children into the world that can help you make a difference and help your legacy will go on and on and on into next generations. So you may or may not get to bear children. That's not the point. What the point is, the most important thing is that you be willing to say yes to whatever plan God has for you. You'll be willing to be the girl that goes against the odds, the girl that goes against the tide, the girl that goes against the social medias that are pushing you to be just like everybody else. You could be that kind of girl. And today as we close our service, you know, will you say the same thing to God that Mary said? Will you say, yes, Lord, I want to be that woman. Will you be that kind of girl? Well, I sure hope you will. See, the invitation is that, you know, you may be young or you may be old, but you can still say yes to the Lord. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've been through. It doesn't matter what you've done. Listen, we serve a God that is the God of the second and third and fourth and 20th chance. And the God that I know and the God that of the Bible can take the phoenix that is ruined and bring it right out of the ashes. See, people say, well, I've ruined my life. My life is shot and I can't be that because look at my life. Look what I've done. Put that out of your mind. A while ago, we saluted the Lord's body and his blood. Remember? That blood of Jesus Christ, the Bible says, cleanses us from all sin. So it doesn't matter what you've done. God will forgive you. And he gives you a chance to start all over. Like a clean slate when you wipe a blackboard or wipe a white chalkboard, you wipe it off and it's all clean, you start again. That's how God is. See, you can start right where you are and be that godly woman that says yes to the Lord. And I want to just challenge you girls. This whole month is going to be a challenge to you to be that kind of girl. Be the woman that will say, yes, Lord, I want to be that kind of girl. Now, we're going to close in prayer and we're going to go that way. Let you out, let the next group come in. But if you want to stay at the altar just for a minute. Come, it's like tagging up in baseball or softball. How many have ever played that sport? When you're on base and they hit a fly ball up to the outfield and you leave the base before you're supposed to, they catch it and throw it back, what happens? You're out of there! See, the devil wants you, he wants to say to you, you're out of there. You're no good. Your life's shot. And I'm here to tell you, no, it's not. Because the God I know, the Jesus I know, has forgiven our sins and cleansed us, and he's given us a brand new start. And when you tag up, the balls hit out there, and you go back, and you wait till they catch it, tag up, then you go, and then you make it around, and you score. Listen. The invitation is for you, and the altar is like that. It's just a tag-up. It's all it is. It's not magical. But when we go that way and the lights go down a little bit, it'll be a private time for you girls. You say, I'm going to the altar, and I'm going to make that commitment to the Lord. I'm going to be that girl. I don't care what everybody else is going to do. As for my life, I'm going to be that girl that tags up with God and says, from here on out, I'm going to be like Mary, and I'm going to say yes to the mission that God is calling me to be, that of a godly woman upon this earth. You may be a mother, you may be married, you may be divorced, irrelevant. What matters is what decision do you make now? What is God saying for you to do right now in this point of your life? And I would say, obey him. Start today by saying, yes, Lord, I'll be that woman for you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, as we start this month of the history of woman, Lord, I pray that you will use it to draw women and girls and ladies, Lord, close to your bosom, Lord. And they will make a commitment to be the kind of girl that Mary was, Lord. Not perfect, but Lord, she was one that set herself apart for you, and she did her best to walk with you, and she accomplished her mission on planet Earth. Lord, I pray that you'll give my sisters and little sisters a chance and an unction, Lord, and a time that they will make that commitment to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And as we go that way, we're going to leave the altar for the ladies that want to come. We're not going to talk to them or bother them unless they need to talk to us. You exit that way and the girls come this way if God told you to do it.